Good afternoon, everyone, and on behalf of English Language Teachers Association of India, we wish you a very happy and prosperous new year. We welcome you to this webinar, and as you know that webinars are being organized by English Language Teachers Association of India, the largest and the oldest network of English teachers. Those who have joined us today, please have a look at our association through a video. Thank you for watching the video. Now, I would like to invite the moderator of the day, Dr. Shobha. She is an assistant professor of English at Anna University, Chennai. And she is also deputy director at the Center for Research, Anna University. She has authored textbooks for Cambridge University Press and Orient Black Swan. And she works in collaboration with SCERT, Government of Andhra Pradesh, TNCHE, NIMI Tamil Nadu, Textbook Corporation, and several other educational programs. Madam, over to you.
Thank you, Shravan. A very warm good afternoon to all of you. And at the outset, let me wish everyone a very successful and stress-free New Year. So let this new year be a very academically productive one for all of us. So today we have come together in another LTI webinar, in fact, the 81st webinar of LTI, on the topic of classroom conundrums, context versus content. And I'm very happy and glad to introduce the resource person for today, a very good friend of mine as well, Dr. Sandhya Venkat. So Dr. Sandhya Venkat is a teaching practitioner with a teaching experience of more than 15 years, imparting knowledge to the primary, secondary, as well as tertiary level learners. She began her career in the Montessori and elementary school system in the US, continued as a teaching fellow at Anna University, and is currently teaching at an international school in Chennai. She completed her doctorate in ELT from Anna University with a high commendation from her Indian and foreign examiners. She has also been a teacher trainer as part of government projects and has played an active role in the upgradation of the general English syllabus and the revision of textbooks for the polytechnic and the government colleges across the state of Tamil Nadu. She was also the recipient of the Anna Centenary Research Fellowship from 2014 to 17 and has also won an award for her presentation on the future of language studies at an international seminar held in Chennai. So her primary interests are teaching methodologies and engaging classrooms. So she will be delivering a session now on classroom conundrums, context versus content. Over to you, Dr. Sandhya.
Thank you, Shobha. I hope you're all able to hear me.
Yes, very much. Please go ahead.
Thank you. A very good evening to everyone here and a very, very happy new year too. So thank you for being here on a Sunday afternoon. So without much or further ado, I would like to proceed. The topic I have chosen to deliver today in this webinar is classroom conundrums, context versus content. Now, this topic involves researches from selected sources along with my reflections and experiences in my teaching and learning journey so far. I would also like to add that I have to acknowledge Google for the extensive use of images I have included in this presentation, just to add some color to this evening. Now, the very term conundrum strike us with a variety of feelings, not new to us as teachers, having encountered almost all of these in our classroom contexts. My primary focus would be on context, as it is the context that determines the methods and approaches we use to deliver the content. When I talk about context, it is from a wider angle through which we are to view our learners based on their environmental, emotional, cultural, social, cultural and social standing, not to mention the edge that they have with the digital citizenship. As independent as content may seem, it is important that the content and the way it is administered be indigenous and suited to the culture and context of learning for the learners. Hence, context matters. Let's see how these contexts matter, and let's see some familiar contexts going forward. Now, these scenarios are quite relatable to most of us as teachers, especially as learners are returning from their zoned out mediums of learning. Now, these are perennial problems. However, the present day context has magnified these and has left us in a state of discomfort, endlessly trying to deal with or trying to pace up with the rapidly changing needs of the learners and their learning environments. I'm sure almost all teachers have faced or witnessed these situations at some point, no matter which geographical context they may belong to. Why is this so? And why does it continue to happen? Do we say it's the problem with the learners? Or should we perhaps redirect our radars to the other side of the classroom, implying not only the coach, but also the content and the course that it takes? And of course, from the student's perspective, from the student's spectacle, of course, they have their own fair share of endless stories to tell. And it makes us wonder if learners will begin to look forward to their learning at some point of time. Some common classroom conundrums make us wonder. I mean, given the influence of access to shortcut learning that most of our learners are adept at, you know, we as teachers are left to scuffle with the sink or sink situations. It is important that we reinforce our views of the educational context more in tandem with the broader picture. When I say the broader picture, we see the small circle. It is not very visible. However, it is relocating the education context at the center or the heart in tandem with the larger context. Once the content aligns with the context, it almost always leads to an enriching experience for both the teachers as well as the learners. So we begin with the context and go from there. Here we are moving on to the context with reference to the learning materials, the context of the materials, the context of the materials that we deliver to the learners. So some common understanding about content versus context with in relation to the materials is described here. Now, teachers are actually the creators of contexts. So in many ways, we are creators of many things. But yes, being creators of context simply means that students don't, when we see the first two lines, students just don't buy stuff. They buy what stuff does for them. I'm using the exact language of most of our learners that they talk when we hear them on our way in and out of the campus. So it simply means that students don't really accept everything we deliver. It's most often not what we deliver, but rather how we deliver that has the direct bearing on the impact on the learner's involvement. As teachers, we create the context of our classrooms, adorning different hats as facilitators, guides, moderators, organizers, sometimes even as friends. So when we meet our learners first, what are we to look at? What are we to look for? All good teaching springs from the basic premise, that is, to know our learners. Where do they come from? Of course, not literally. Where do they stand? And then to understand where they are heading towards. With regard to the psychology of the learners, we need to know. Are you able to hear me? I'm kind of blacked out in my screen for a minute.
Yeah, you are.
Okay. So, yes. Understanding what students know or think they know while coming into our courses can help us design our instruction more appropriately. Yes, students do not come into our courses as blank slates, but rather with knowledge gained in other courses and through daily life. Yeah, just for an example, with regard to the psychology of the learners, you know, the writing parameters, from a little bit of my experience, when I ask my learners to use the writing parameters, or if I tell them to write a compare contrast essay as they walk into my classrooms for the first time, as they are transitioning from the previous grade to my grade, you know, their experience in relation to science, making it less qualitative and formatting them in appropriate sentence structures is really struggling. Most of my learners have their majors as sciences. And when they come to my class and when I'm asking them to write essays, sometimes they tend to write it, especially with regard to this compare and contrast essay. They start writing in points, like how they do in their lab reports. So these kind of nuances that they are familiar with need to be addressed as they walk into our classrooms and help them to unlearn, not really to unlearn, but rather to relearn and apply it appropriately, whatever learning that they have gathered from their previous experiences. Excuse me. Prior knowledge helps. Does it really help or does it hinder learners' performances? Now, according to Vygotsky and the National Research Council put forth in 2000, students connect what they learn to what they already know, interpreting incoming information and even sensory perception through the lens of their existing knowledge, beliefs, and assumptions, as we just saw before. In fact, there is widespread agreement among researchers that students must connect new knowledge to previous knowledge in order to learn. Because knowing what is a very different kind of knowledge than knowing how or knowing when, it is especially important that we are clear in our own minds about the knowledge requirements of different tasks. However, the extent to which students are able to draw on prior knowledge as the instructor, as well as the instructor's ability to harness it appropriately, is very important. Students learn more readily when they can connect what they are learning to what they already know. However, it is not to be assumed that students will immediately or naturally draw on relevant prior knowledge. So it is important that we deliberately activate students' prior knowledge to help them forge robust links to new knowledge. So this should be done deliberately and painstakingly. Assessing prior knowledge. Now, assessing prior knowledge can be done normally or generally. The rule of thumb is that we use diagnostic assessments or do a needs analysis. Diagnostic assessments are definitely important considering considering that they are low stakes assessments, such as a quiz or an essay, whereas concept inventories are ungraded tests, typically in a multiple choice format, that are designed to include incorrect answers to actually help reveal common misconceptions. So that really helps us to clarify these common misconceptions. Scaffolding learners, for example, students may have experience with writing from a science course, which I just told about the lab report, and you know, or they may have an understanding of from a history course as to how to write an analytical paper or a personal narrative from the English language. So they will need to know which set of knowledge and skills is the appropriate one to build on. It is important to explicitly identify the norms we expect from them to follow. Without explicit guidance, students may analogize from other experiences or fields that they feel most competent in, regardless of whether the experiences are appropriate in the current context. So, with regard to analogies, before asking students to read an article from the 1970s, we can, for an understanding of a poetry or a poet's background, we might ask them what was going on historically at that time that might have triggered or informed the author's perspective. So most of us do that in our literature classes, or whenever we discuss about, when we begin a lesson about the author, we do discuss about the background. So these kind of understanding really help them. So when they are able to make cross-curricular integration with regard to these kind of background knowledge that we are trying to elicit and that we are trying to guide them to go forward. Motivation is a very, very important aspect. Whatever the context, the success of a learning environment is directly proportional to the classroom engagement. So in the context of learning, motivation influences the direction, intensity, persistence, and quality of the learning behaviors in which students engage. Students' motivation generates, directs, and sustains what they do to learn. Not how they do, but here it is what they do. The edifice of education encompasses various stakeholders, from textbook writers to curriculum developers to parents, learners. institutions, the administrative wing, and all of them. And yet the greatest impact is made by the classroom teachers. And as English language teachers, all the more so, since it provides the basis for most of the learning that happens in our classrooms across various subject areas. When we make explicit connections between the content of our course and other courses to come, students can better understand the value of each course as a building block for future courses. For example, critical reasoning, public speaking, persuasive writing, clear communication, effective resolution of disagreements when they are doing their teamwork or group discussions, consideration of multiple perspectives will all help them in their future while they are doing their team building or in their professional lives. So when we bring that kind of link to why they are learning, they would be much more motivated. For example, students often complain about being graded on the quality of their writing in their compare contrast essays, as I just told you, and or in any essay, because they tend to make it very brief or very to the point. And then because they are used to those kind of learning in many other subject areas. And hence, when they come for a narrative or a descriptive piece, when they attempt it, they tend to be very brief. Or it may be sometimes the other way around also, when they don't have points, they tend to ramble on and on with rigmaroles. Would this concept be relevant to anything else we have studied? These are kind of questions that we can ask and elicit responses for them to make the necessary connections. So think back to the burger example that we discussed last week with regard to how you will organize your essay. These things can help them make connections that facilitate the transfer of knowledge from what they are learning here to other subjects and also to the outside world, wherever it is required. I'm moving on to the thinking routines. Now, Harvard University has come up with this Project Zero. Project Zero's broader work on visible thinking can be defined as a flexible and systematic research-based approach to integrating the development of students' thinking with content learning across subject matters. An extensive and adaptable collection of practices are used here. These routines enable the processing of ideas and to work with the content. So the visible thinking research has a double goal. On the one hand, to cultivate students' thinking skills and dispositions, and on the other, to deepen content knowledge. These are some of the visible thinking routines that we do use, you know, even though it's Harvard's Project Zero. This is a common thing that we do use. Most of us as teachers, we have been using these thinking hats, and Edward de Bono is very popular with those thinking with his thinking hat. So often the questions, why, what if, suppose that, what if we knew, what are the reasons, what would change if, what is the purpose of, how would it be different? These kind of sentence starters or question starters for us to enable statements that can elicit responses from the learners based on the lessons that we are administering would definitely get them thinking. These are some of the ways to initiate and also to direct their thinking. Now, for example, a routine like sharing headlines in the class. I do it with my learners during each of my sessions. I encourage learners to give me the headline of the day. Any headline that interests them, no matter which area or branch of knowledge it is. So the aim is to make them read regularly and to summarize their understanding of whatever they have learned or read and to share it. So a routine like headlines, which is all about capturing the heart and considering what is the core idea or the core issue here, and summing that up in a single headline is definitely very helpful for them to use their summarizing skills later. So the goal is to do that summary. So whenever we want to achieve that goal, then thinking on those lines is a good match within that. Developing a culture of learning. The next engaging paradigms are adapted from the total participation techniques by the Himili authors. So now when we are developing the culture of thinking, we do need to ask these kinds of questions. Do I need them to be making connections? Do I need them to be building explanations? And do I need them to be considering different perspectives? All of these we do use often. And yet sometimes we tend to bypass these based on the competencies of the learners. But in a classroom with mixed ability groups, it is often important for us to revisit this quite often. So based on the kinds of thinking we want with a specific content, we choose a routine which helps students to do that kind of thinking. In that way, when students are using thinking in order to learn, they are also learning to think as a result of that. It seems and sounds very simple, and yet we see them deficient when it comes to most often articulating their thoughts and ideas without giving sufficient thought to it. Now, this total participation techniques, these are higher order questionings or higher order thinking skills are elicited through these. So where higher order questioning is concerned, the metaphor about tossing beach balls present quality learning options for volunteers, but offers no guarantees that any of the other students are involved. This is very important, that most often what we do is we ask questions. We just throw a question open to the floor in our sessions. And we often see students, the same volunteers who always put their hands up. And of course, if we are short of time, we tend to just stick to them and get the responses so that the rest of them can be benefited by listening to them and we proceed further. But this does not offer guarantee that all the students are involved in the process. All the students are interested or, are even learning in the process. So in other words, when it comes to engaging students in higher order question and answers, calling on someone is fine, but sequentially, it could be the last thing that we can do. So questions are fine, but when we are asking these questions like, who can tell me this? Who can tell me, what is the theme of what we were doing in the last week in our poetry? I'm sure there would be hands raised. But when we call out, say, student A, I'm sure student A is the only one who's going to benefit from that. Of course, the others might be listening, but we all know that there are learners who shy away either to answer, and some of them who lazy, who zone out from even observing what is happening in the class. So in order to address that, it is important that we do not stick to the beach ball metaphor. Rather, think of other ways to proceed. Developing higher order thinking skills. So when it comes to asking higher order questions, it is not enough that we create higher order questions. Not every question deserves the attention that a ripple would provide. We are talking about the ripple analogy here. These are all higher order thinking skill activities developed by Persida and William Himili. And we are going to look at how these are useful for learners. So not every question deserves the attention that a ripple would provide, but students will often benefit from this type of attention placed on higher order thinking skills or higher order questions rather. The second higher order, the second activity that they are suggesting is the chalkboard splash. So, the chalkboard splash is a very interesting activity. It allows teachers to get a quick read on their students' thinking and also allows for students to review their peers' responses, looking for tendencies or surprises or analyzing for big picture themes. So we need to embed opportunities within the classroom structures that allow for all the students to respond. So students respond to a higher order prompt in their notebooks. This is the first step. They just make responses in their notebooks or in some designated slips of papers that we might hand over to them. And then they trim their responses to a minimum of 15 words. And following that, they grab a piece of chalk or whiteboard marker, depending on whatever we have in our classrooms. And they record their abbreviated responses on any open spot on the chalkboard or whiteboard. So again, in the given context, Indian context, having larger classrooms is a given. So it is very important that we address those parameters while we are doing the chalkboard splash. Most of our classrooms will have a minimum of 30 to 40 students. And when we are addressing the chalkboard splash activity, it is quite possible that the board might not be big enough to allow all the learners to put in their responses, or you might see a huge queue or a ruckus created by the class students when they are standing there to share their views through the chalkboard activity. So there is an alternate to this where the teachers can bring the charts to the table. They can bring huge charts, chart papers, and divide it into columns and rows wherein they can just give, it's only 15 word responses which can be further trimmed, and we can ask them to just put the key elements there just to have an idea as to what they think about the question being elicited. So they can do that on the chart paper too. So whatever activities Emily has suggested is definitely very, very adaptable to any classroom size. So I'm just sharing this for a smaller classroom. We can always scale it up or scale it down depending on the requirements or the strength of the class. We have a sample here. A lesson on a Japanese work that included an overview of Eleanor Kerr's Sudoku. So this is from a seventh teacher who had students do a quick write initially. That was the first step where they had to write their first responses. And then he asked them to connect what they have been learning about Hiroshima in their history lessons. So this is another way of where we may call it content-based instruction, but it is not entirely content-based instruction, but it is more we can also call it CLIL, but again, it is more of cross-curricular integration wherein we connect with the history, with their history sessions. Most often, language, English language does have lots of connections with history, the subject history. So we can collaborate with the history teachers to bring in that kind of relevance to the classrooms, to bring in that kind of connection that students can make, which helps in internalizing what they are learning very deeply. So a young Japanese girl who developed leukemia from her radiation, and she's very interested to create origami. She spent her time in her nursing home creating origami cranes in the hope of making 1,000 of them for a different reason. So students respond to the prompt. What was it about Sudoku that made the Japanese people feel connected to her and proud of her? So this is the prompt that has been given to them. So they summarize, first they respond to it in their papers, and then they summarize it as main points or in 15 words or so, in a sentence or two, and then they grab a piece of chalk or write in the chart papers and on the board. If they are using the board, they write it on the board. So students read their peers' responses and develop a summary statement that highlights similarities and differences in point of view. Now, this is the last step where they might be organized into circles where they can go back after finishing writing, after each of them take turns to move from one circle to another to read all the prompts and then give their final inputs. Say one student from a group can speak up towards the end. So although the final response is highlighting similarities and differences in point of view, the thing is, students are engaged throughout. and they get the inputs from all the learners. They get to see various viewpoints. And of course, this is a time-taking activity. We might need two sessions or, we could conclude it in two sessions if it's a very large classroom. But this is definitely a beneficial activity I have tried in my classes, and it has worked very well. So. One more thing, one more example with a chalkboard splash sample, and especially when I spoke about the cross-curricular integration or the transdisciplinary approach. When we say that, yes, we did a poetry by Shelley, Ozymandias, and he's a romantic poet. So students were very encouraged and very interested because they were doing the Roman era. They were doing the civilization, the Roman civilization in their history classes. And I did get to collaborate with your social science teachers. And we were able to make relevant connections between the Romantic era and the Roman age and what it meant. What really the Romans were inclined towards, how what kind of importance was given towards nature, and identifying themselves more with nature and normal lives away from war and looking towards peace. All of these elements came together. And in, likewise, we also integrated with the mathematics teachers as to how the Roman letters or the Roman numericals came into existence and how they incorporated those in their language, in their subjects. So this kind of cross-curricular integration really, really helps build that kind of collaborative atmosphere when they meet students from other branches. And also when teachers collaborate, there is a lot of broadening and widening of learning happening either way. Developing higher order thinking skills. So we, as part of that, we have the third one. First, we saw the beach ball was not really a higher order thinking skill. So the ripple was the first one. And then it was the chalkboard splash. And then we have seen, this is actually the third one by mistake that it's been placed as a second. So the debate team carousel is another interesting activity, which is pretty intense. But once we start doing it in the classroom, it is definitely a big win-win with the learners. So these are done in small group circles. Students are able to think deeper, build off others' thinking, and add inferences to take their thinking further. It also gives us different perspectives on those who don't normally participate orally. So we have, again, several steps. Students reflect on their reading and address the prompt, very similar to what we saw with the chalkboard splash. This is another prompt. Should children be allowed to work on farms? This may sound very elementary, but again, we are addressing learners, teachers across the spectrum. So I thought we could take this example. So students are asked to hold their answers and search for supporting evidence. Next step, they fill in the first box. Now I'll share with you the box that they are doing. So these are prepared materials that we hand over to the learners. Very simple sheets of paper divided into four boxes. And this really helps because let me read out what they do in the second step. So they fill in the first box on the debate team carousel sheets, which asks them to write down their opinion and give a reason why they thought that way, whatever opinion they have given. So the sample student reflection here is children should work on farms because it would help the farmers. That was one response. And students pass their papers to the person sitting right immediately to their right. And these students address the prompt in the second box. So it's like a continuing activity, a progressive activity from one student to another, which can be done by dividing learners into small groups. So everyone to their right will get to respond. Unless, of course, if we do it for an entire class, it is going to become very overwhelming. So small groups, dividing them into small groups and doing it will definitely benefit. So students pass their papers. So once the second student writes their responses, students pass their papers to the person sitting to their right again. Now, those students address the prompt in the second box, which asks them to read the classmates' responses and add another reason why they supported that point of view. So this was the sample response. By working on farms, children might be more likely to want to own a farm when they grow up. So this is kind of a substantiating or a supporting her or his immediate neighbor's response. So the next step will be, after initializing the second box, the students again pass the paper to the person sitting to their right, who was asked to refute what was written in boxes 1 and 2, again initialing his or her response. Now, each of these students do write their small names or initialing it very simply. And initialing his or her response, several students suggested that children shouldn't work on forms because it's too dangerous. When we tried to collect the responses from several groups, most of the students responded negatively. But again, since we give this option of supporting the views as well as refuting the views, they are encouraged to respond giving both options. So the papers are passed once again, and this time asking the recipients to read the comments in all three boxes, state their opinion, and provide reasons why they held that opinion. This comes to the last part. So the papers were then returned to their original owners, who were eager to read their peers' arguments for and against their initial positions. Now, this might be a confusion wherein only the student A who has begun the process gets to read all these responses. But then when this student is reading it out to the rest of the class, they get to hear the perspectives and the responses of all their peers, all their co-group members. So this is, again, a very, very enriching activity for the learners. And it doesn't really take much of our time, because when we give them those sheets of paper, they are very motivated to write, responding to someone else's points. Now, this is the sample worksheet. Of course, this is the source from Himili and Himili. So I would like you to take a look at it, wherein, you know, the first student has written a response, and the next student to their right would have responded by supporting the view. And then we have the refuting view followed by the final response. Now, there are several engagement strategies as practitioners, as teaching practitioners. Most of us would have definitely used most of these engagement strategies. I have just taken this image out of Google, because most of it we can relate to. And there are so many of these engagement strategies, and yet we always justify not using most of these merely on the basis of large classrooms, bigger strength, shorter time, the crunch to finish the syllabus. All of these are definitely there. But then when we use students as partners in learning, and when we get their inputs, and when we get their help, and when we help ask them to format rubrics for those, it is just unbelievable how they come up with different ideas. And as little helpers, to promote learning in the classroom, to promote these engagement in the classroom. It really helps when we have small leaders for each of these groups, and they take the ownership for that. So there can be another So this debate team carousel, what we saw, it helps teachers to strategically pair the students based on the analysis. We don't have to necessarily take the pain to correct each and every student's responses. While the action is in process, we go on rounds as facilitators, and we check and we understand how each student responds. And according to that, in our oncoming act or ensuing activities, we strategically pair students who tend to demonstrate more shallow thinking with those who consistently model deeper thinking. At the same time, not make it too overwhelming for them. So another engagement strategy that we can do is also, finally, when we finish a certain lesson and we do have some time at hand during that session, we can ask them to do an A to Z sentence wrap-up. It's just amazing when I have tried this in my classes, where learners wrap up the participation technique activity, any one of those. So they wrap up and, in one sentence alphabetically. So we can call out the letters, any letter from the alphabet, and they respond with your sentences starting from that respective letter as to how their understanding of the lesson was, or how, basically reflecting on it. So this is kind of an A to Z sentence wrap up that I'm talking about. Now, although we all talk about learner engagement being very, very important, it is very important that we do not mess up with the classroom ethos, as Bramfit says. So learning can be fun. Learning ought to be fun too, but learning is also serious business. So does engagement equal learning? A very important question. Students can be thoroughly engaged in their activity and still walk away having learned very little about the content that we were hoping to teach. So this happens quite often. So it is very, very important that not only participation of learners should be encouraged, but also the teachers are to ensure that cognitive engagement, meaningful engagement, understanding of the concepts take place. So only when active participation matches with cognitive engagement, when both happens together, that leads to a total participation wherein engagement equals learning. So students can also be encouraged to do quick writes. Sometimes we see that whenever this time crunch happens, and when we want to see where our learners are, or when we want to help our learners to develop their writing skills, it's very helpful to give them small prompts and ask them to just write 5 sentences about those, not in pointers, but something on the go. We can just think of those on the go. While we are even walking to classes, sometimes we come up with things that we would give as prompts for them, and they could just do that. And there are also other options wherein we have hold-ups, wherein students, we have designated cards in the classrooms which says true, not true, or true with modifications. So each of these learners can have these 3 small cards in their desks. It's not much to ask for. So as we finish our lessons, as educators, when we finish our lessons, we can ask them, how has this lesson been? Were you able to understand? And then whenever we elicit such responses, they can show those hold-ups. These are for learners who are extremely shy. They prefer to show hold-ups rather than talking. Of course, we have to encourage them to talk at some point, but these are starters that really help them. So as educators, our ultimate goal ought to be to get students to not just be able to regurgitate what we have taught, but to experience it in a way that causes them to deeply understand it and its relevance towards life. So it is important just not to engage our students, but to cognitively engage them by really causing them to think deeply about the content that we are teaching. Assessments. So now that we have seen engagements, and before that, how to initiate thinking, how to elicit responses about their prior knowledge, we are moving on to assessments. So we all know these differences, the basic differences between formative and summative assessments. And I'm very, very keen on formative assessments because that informs our teaching, and we constantly learn in the process and modify our teaching accordingly. But the present day predicaments, of course, most of us, when we teach tertiary level learners especially, this is something that we have seen or experienced, the second picture. I'm not sure which is more exciting, proctoring a test or sitting through an in-service on how to proctor a test. Now, these are problems that we teachers always go through, trying to, again, pace up, keep up with the completely changing needs, making us want to become digital natives. So this is very important. And yes, it is a challenge, and yet we swim through it. So far, we have swam through it. So Now, this is another image, a lot of theory. So I thought that I could add in some images here. So are our assessments preparing learners to meet the challenges of the outside world is one of the biggest questions here. So we always know we harp on, we always depend and what do we call? We certify a student, we qualify a student, we judge a student based on their tests. So much of emphasis has been laid on tests that students at some point when they hit the corporate environments, we see them often struggling with these kind of issues. So formative assessments can be considered as ongoing checkpoints, constantly, as I told, how we would be altering our lessons according to the requirements of the learners. So teachers first find out where children are in their learning journey. And then they say, say if we have allocated 4 hours or 4 sessions for a specific lesson, it would be prudent to have at least one of those hours to do a formative assessment. It need not necessarily be an assessment where grading or marking is important, but it is very, very essential for us to do, for us to have an analysis from reading what they have written. So more than correcting, it is for us to have an analysis. And when we see those, we get to address those issues. And if it is across the class, of course, we can do it as another session entirely to address those. And if it is only for a few learners, then definitely we can focus more on those papers and give them qualitative feedback or specific feedback that would help them improve their learning process. Now, it is very important in general, having the learning objective up on the board. Yes, this is another thing. Many of us, when we start a lesson, we tend to see what ought to be the learning outcome of the class. What are the learning objectives? So, but it is very important that, you know, having the learning objective up on the board or speaking it explicitly is okay. But as an orthodoxy, or, you know, as having it as a rule of thumb for classroom teaching, it is definitely not okay. So this is what Dylan Williams says. So if I want my students to analyze a poem by T.S. Eliot, it is okay. Definitely poetry lends itself to lots of interpretations. So if I'm going to say this is, if I'm going to be very precise and specific in my learning objective, and when students, students' responses can be generic. It can branch out into various tangents. It may not be very specific. So we have to be able to give them that kind of autonomy to stretch their thinking. And this happens, of course, in the college level when with the literature courses. However, at the school level, it is important that we do not give them the objectives right away. So it is okay to give it somewhere in the middle of the session or somewhere during the middle of the unit that we are, delivering. So being too precise about where it is we are going reduces the chance for students to be creative. Sometimes telling learners where you are going supports the journey, but oftentimes beginning every single lesson with an objective might defeat the purpose. Framing learning objectives. So the learning intentions should be very broad and transcendent. It's very important. So it should be away from the specificities of what is being taught to applying their knowledge in different contexts. So that way, it is important that the learners move a little away from the specificities and ensure, example, we can see that a lesson on the unit of when we teach for functional language, how to teach persuasive elements. And when we start with a topic of the language of advertisements, the learning objectives can be framed as the impact of slogans and taglines and advertisements. And we can definitely play videos and show them so many audio visual elements, bring realia to the classroom. However, a better way of framing the objective could help them understand that these activities are catered towards the use of persuasive language to create impact. This way, we are moving away from the specificities and giving them that kind of understanding as to how it can be used in a broader context. Now, where are learners in their current journey? This is the second aspect of the formative assessments. So statements rather than questions can lead to deeper and more thoughtful responses. More often, we tend to think that we ask questions. As teachers, I think it is inherent in us that we have to ask questions. So it just happens that we ask questions quite often. So it is important that questions are asked. However, in academic subjects, there is research that shows that merely asking questions can close down discussions. So I'm just going to, for want of time, I'm just going to quickly show a sample of teaching punctuations. So instead of asking questions, whether you understood punctuations, you understood how where to use comma, the teacher just puts on the board, it's on its way. And she asks them to come and fill it up with punctuations. And of course, it's a very small sentence with very less opportunities for applying punctuations. However, it certainly helps learners to participate, triggers their imagination. And this gives you as a teacher as to how much they have understood. So do you think anything else need to be added? Can be the final question. So it is okay to ask questions at the end, but not at the beginning. So again, speaking thumb is something that we can use to understand how their learning engagement is. So that can also be towards the end after knowing if they have that they have engaged quite well in the sessions. Feedback, the emphasis on feedback. Feedback can never be overstated. So some research on feedback shows its Jekyll and Hyde character. So not all students about feedback show positive effects. The nature of the feedback and the context in which it is given matter a great deal. So Susan Brookhart is a wonderful author. Her feedback strategies I have used in my classrooms. So it is very important that we use feedback to inform our teaching as well as to inform students' progress. There are several types of feedback focus. We have to focus more on the purpose, the timing. It's very important, the timing on feedback, giving timing feedback and giving timely feedback. And as soon as they are done with the task or while the task is in progress, definitely enables them to study smarter, but not harder, and focusing on the trouble spots then and there. So these are examples of good feedback focus and bad feedback focus. I'm not going to take too much time showing this to you because most of us already know this. So you can just skim through it. Yes, it is very important that learners are made to understand that they are the owners of learning, of their own learning. So this is extremely important. And this kind of gives them the onus and the responsibility to address their shortcomings in the process. There are several strategies to help students learn to use feedback. So these are most of them we are already using. However, I feel that no matter how many times we use, oft times I see myself referring to this. What feedback need not be, of course, most of us know. So it is very important that we feed forward, that feedback is effective if it feeds forward. If we provide opportunities for learners to feed forward what they have learned through the feedback. I'm closing with this powerful quote by Einstein, empowering learners. So this is very important. As I told, we ask questions, but when we let the students ask us questions, as many questions as they can, I'm sure we are empowering learners in the process. So with this, I close my session today. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you, Dr. Sandhya. Indeed, it was a very interactive presentation because I could see a lot of questions coming up. And the way that you had structured the presentations, you spoke about the engagement strategies and then about assessment and then about feedback. I think that's a very, a thoughtful way of presenting your ideas. So we do have certain questions here. I hope you would be able to answer them briefly. We have this question from Gurapu Damodar. His question is, National Education Policy 2020 intends to make our children how to think, but not what to think. What is your strategy to promote it in our classroom common rooms?
Yes, as I said, you know, we can think about the Edward de Bono's hats, thinking hats. It is very, very important that I'm sure I also mentioned this there in the presentation that, yes, we can elicit learners, you know, we can tell them how to think, especially when I told, think about the burger model, think about the burgers. How are the burgers organized when they are writing a piece, the introduction and then the body and then the conclusion? This is a very simple analogy that I'm giving here. But again, when we give them some kind of metaphors, some kind of analogies that they can relate to real life, that really helps them to think, how to think, how to make relevant connections to real life, how to make connections to something that is very, very interesting to learners, to the age of the learners that you are addressing. So that really helps rather than giving them exactly and explicitly what they want to think, what we want us to think. I mean, I'm sorry, what we want them to think.
Exactly. I think, you know, thinking is a very complex process and you cannot be very explicit in saying what they have to think. Okay, another question coming your way from Lakshmi. What do you mean by cognitive engagement in the learning process and how do you justify it in the regular practices?
Yes, cognitive engagement is meaningful engagement. They understand what we want to teach, what are our final objectives, although we do not have to state it explicitly. When you are teaching them, for example, recommendations, how do you write recommendations? What is it? What is the language that you need to use, the modals? How are you going to tell them? What do you mean by cognitive engagement? So initially, we start with how you use modals rather than explicitly stating modals are being used. Or for example, if you're going to teach prepositions, I know this might be very elementary, but believe me, a lot of us still make mistakes with prepositions. Yes. So when we do prepositions, I know once Dr. Saraswati, the legend, she actually, I learned quite a bit from that presentation wherein she would just come to class and this is what she told us, that drop a chalk somewhere. And she would ask the learners, she would elicit responses by asking, do you know where my, either a chalk or a pen, do you know where my pen is? I just had it. So can you tell me where it is? And the learners are going to constantly respond. It's behind you, beneath you, above you, on the table, you know, in front of you or, you know, whatever. So in that process, you are allowing them to use the prepositions. So that is cognitive engagement. That is meaningful engagement. They know they are using what we want them to learn by, you know, we are not really explicitly stating that to them. So I hope I answered your question.
Exactly. I think cognitive engagement has more to do with the kind of examples that you gave. And that's a very good example that you gave. So thank you, Dr. Sandhya, again, for the presentation and for the question and answer session as well. I hand over now the session to Kumar Shravan.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Venkat. Thank you, Dr. Shobha, for engrossing session. There are two important announcements for the participants. The certificates will be sent to the email. A link will be provided to you and you all can fill the details in it. And we hope that you all will be joining us for our next session on 9th January for teaching advanced English sentence and structure. Hoping to see you all once again on 9th January. Till then, stay safe, stay healthy. Thank you, everyone.